Hey guys, welcome to my very first YouTube video and also episode one of Airplane Anatomy. I am so excited to share this series with you guys where I'm going to be breaking down different airplanes from start to finish, from their first production to their final flight and everything in between. So it's gonna be a lot of engineering, a little bit of physics, a little bit of history and design, but mainly just me fangirling over airplanes. So of course today we need to talk about an icon of aviation, one of the fastest and highest flying planes that's ever been built, and also the namesake of Elon Musk's new baby. Of course, it's the Blackbird family. Specifically, we're going to be talking about the SR-71 Blackbird. So I'm going to leave some timestamps here if you want to skip ahead to different sections. Otherwise, without further ado, let's get started. So you might be wondering, where did demand for such an aircraft come from to begin with? Well, it was arguably due to one single incident, and that was with the U-2 plane. So the U-2 at the time was used as a reconnaissance or spy plane, used to gather information about what's going on the ground, whether it be photographing military bases or looking at strategic positions, etc. So in 1960, at the onset of the Cold War, a U-2 plane was shot down over Soviet Union. So people soon realized that at the pace that the Soviet Union was developing their missiles and their radar technology, that the U-2 plane would soon become obsolete. So President Eisenhower at the time asked Lockheed Martin, which was the company that produced the U-2, to make a better and faster version of the U-2 that would essentially never get shot down. So of course, this was a very difficult task that was given to the Advanced Development Group at Lockheed Martin, also codenamed Skunk Works. So an engineer at Skunk Works was called Kelly Johnson, and he would later become one of the key contributors of the entire Blackbird project. So in February of 1960, the CIA signed a $96 million contract with Lockheed Martin for them to produce 12 of these new Blackbird planes, and the program was a go. Now, of course, designing an airplane that flew faster and higher than ever before was no easy task. And on top of that, they had to be able to take pictures from the airplane as well. So one of the first issues was, of course, heat. In order for the airplane to be flying at Mach 3, or 3 times the speed of sound, the airplane would be subject to temperatures of up to 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit, or 500 degrees Celsius. That is very hot. This is due to the air particles that collide with the leading edge of the aircraft, essentially converting their kinetic energy into thermal energy, or heat. So the faster you fly, the higher heat tolerance that the airplane needs to have. Now, of course, at the same time, the temperature outside is extremely cold. For example, at 70,000 feet, it is minus 67 degrees Fahrenheit outside. So that means parts of the aircraft will be subject to extreme cold while other parts are in extreme heat. So the solution that Lockheed Martin came up with to solve this problem was actually very simple. It was black paint. Now, since black both emits and absorbs heat, it was able to distribute evenly the heat across the entire surface. In addition to the black paints, titanium was also used to manufacture 90% of the airplane, which was very rare at the time. So titanium was chosen because it holds up in high temperatures, but is also lightweight enough to fly. Now, the downside of using titanium was that it was extremely brittle. It was said that during the first heat-treated batch of titanium parts that they would actually shatter on the ground if you dropped them from the table. Now, of course, they fixed this later on, but it was also found that on assembly lines, the steel tools that workers normally used to manufacture the airplane would actually damage the titanium material. So in order to manufacture the plane, the entire set of tools had to be remade using titanium instead. Now, ironically, the USSR at the time was one of the biggest suppliers of titanium in the world. So in order for the US to get their hands on this large supply of titanium, they had to make up, you know, bogus companies or do it through third world countries. And it was actually very ironic that the USSR ended up basically being a sponsor to a program that would eventually surveil their own country. Now remember, another main goal of designing the Blackbird was stealth, or in other words, the ability to appear as small as possible to enemy radar to avoid being detected. Now in order to do this, the engineers came up with groundbreaking designs for the physical aircraft with very smooth curves and flat surfaces and edges that were considered super futuristic for its time. And in addition to that, the black paint that the Blackbird uses also contains iron ferrite particles, which help absorb radar as well. And it actually used a very special fuel that contained cesium. And how it worked was, after being burnt through the engines, the afterburners, and being expelled through the exhaust, it would actually create a cloud of plasma behind the airplane that helped absorb any electromagnetic waves, so in this case radar, so that it wouldn't be reflected back to the ground. Now there are so many different problems that the engineers ended up facing to design the Blackbird, and so many creative solutions that they came up with to solve those problems. For example, designing a new suit and mask to sustain the crew in case of an ejection at extremely high speeds and extremely high altitudes. And also even coming up with a brand new tanker aircraft in order to refuel the Blackbird at very high speeds. Now these are extremely interesting challenges that we don't really have time to go into today, but I'll leave some links down below if you want to do some further reading. So in April of 1962, the Blackbird flew for the very first time. Now this was not the SR-71, this was called the A-12. The A-12 Blackbird. So eventually, three different variants were made of the A-12 Blackbird. The first was the YF-21, which was an interceptor plane that was armed with air-to-air missiles for the US Air Force. Now, unfortunately, it never went past its prototype stages and never went into operation. The second variant was called the M-21, which was designed to be an actual drone carrier. It looked like the Blackbird, but with a pylon on top where the drone would sit and be deployed from. Now, unfortunately, during testing, one of the drones collided with the mothership and actually caused the death of one pilot, so the program was shortly canceled after that. So, of course, the third variant was the SR-71, standing for Strategic Reconnaissance. Now, the difference between SR-71 and the A-12 was that the SR-71 had two seats instead of one, where you have a pilot sitting in the front and obviously flying the plane, and a reconnaissance systems officer sitting in the back, where he'd be handling the navigation, the different systems, as well as the camera equipment, etc. In addition to that, the SR-71 also had additional fuel capacity than the A-12. Now, in order to counteract this additional passenger as well as the fuel weights, some of the camera equipment had to be downgraded on the SR-71. So the A-12 now was a plane that was optimized for the CIA, and now the SR-71 was created for the US Air Force. And in December of 1964, the first SR-71 Blackbird took to the skies for the very first time. After the SR-71 entered service in 1966 with the US Air Force, it began just breaking records left and right. It became the fastest jet in the world with a cruising speed of Mach 3.3, with top speeds of up to 3.5 recorded. Now, for comparison, if you look at the passenger jet of today, like this Boeing 747 or the Airbus A380, they have a top cruising speed of around Mach 0.8. The Concorde, which was the fastest passenger jet, had the top speed of Mach 2, which is similar to the top speeds of different fighter jets like the F-22 or the F-35 today. Similarly, the SR-71 also broke records in terms of its operational ceiling, or the max altitude at which it could fly, which was 85,000 feet. Again, for comparison, the typical airliner today flies below 45,000 feet. The U-2 plane, which the SR-71 replaced, had a max ceiling of 60,000 feet, which is similar to the ceiling of different fighter jets that we have today. So this just goes to show how incredible this SR-71 plane was for its time. Although, to be fair, a lot of these fighter aircrafts or commercial airliners are obviously not designed with the same goals in mind as the SR-71 once did. Because of the extreme capabilities of the SR-71 at the time, none were ever shot down. In interviews with pilots, they said that if they had a missile locked on them, they would simply change direction and speed up to outfly the missile. The MiG-25s of the Soviet Union at the time were also no competitor to the SR-71 as well. However, this badass plane didn't come without its drawbacks. For one, the plane was considered slightly unreliable, meaning that flights would come back with rivets or screws missing, or just generally with parts that need replacement or repair. Because of this, the plane actually averaged around only one flight per week, which was considered very slow. Although no planes were shot down, 12 of the 34 SR-71s produced were actually lost due to mechanical failures. The plane from production to takeoff also required an army of people and resources to support it. For example, before takeoff, in order to start the plane, the engines actually each required a start cart, which was a truck that drove underneath each engine and actually got it spinning enough to 3,000 RPM in order for the engine to self-sustain. The aircraft also took off with very minimal fuel in order to reduce the stress on its tires and its brakes, and would get refueled immediately after takeoff. Flying the plane was no easy task either. Pilots said that they needed to keep the nose within 1 or 2 degrees of the prescribed angle in order for it to be stable, meaning that the aircraft is constantly at the edge of losing control. In addition to that, there was a very common engine problem known as an inlet unstart. On the SR-71, in front of the engine inlet was a cone that could actually move backwards up to 3 feet in order to readjust the position of the shockwave to reduce drag. Now, if this cone is in a slightly off position, it could lead to a buildup of internal pressure that eventually releases by violently blowing out the front and basically blowing the shockwave forward instead of back. This often caused the engine to be extinguished, meaning that there is thrust being produced by one engine on one side and none being produced on the other, meaning that there is a very violent yaw to one side for the aircraft. This is, of course, extremely dangerous and actually led to the loss of one of the SR-71 planes. The SR-71 stayed in service with the US Air Force until October of 1989, when the program was shut down. The last Blackbird made its flight from Los Angeles to Washington, D.C. in 64 minutes, which actually broke 4 records at the time. Now, there are many different theories as to why the SR-71 went out of service. A lot of people said that it was because it was too expensive. At the time, the SR-71s cost $34 million each, which would be equal to $280 million today. Although it's widely disputed, some people say that it cost upwards of $200,000 an hour to operate, and the fuel alone costs $37,000 an hour. Now, that's much faster than burning cash. A lot of people also attributed the unreliability of the SR-71 as one of its downfalls. Now, it's very important to also look at the political climate at that time. So in the 70s and the early 80s, a lot of the commanders and the pilots of the SR-71s were promoted to higher positions within the Air Force. So in those positions, they did a really great job of highlighting the value of the SR-71 program to Congress. As it got to the later 80s, a lot of those generals ended up retiring and got replaced with a newer generation of generals who thought that maybe there was more value in developing new bomber programs, for example, the B-2 plane. So as a result, the SR-71 program was cut, and unfortunately, they are not seen in the skies anymore. However, in 1999, NASA flew 2 Blackbirds in order to conduct high altitude and high speed flight research, and that was the last known flight of the Blackbird. Most of them, unfortunately, live in museums today. So what follows the legacy of the SR-71? Well, most of the missions conducted by the SR-71 back then are now being performed by unmanned aerial vehicles, or AUVs, better known as drones. Now, of course, these are much safer and cost-effective methods to perform the same reconnaissance missions as the SR-71s did back then. So unfortunately, it is very unlikely that the SR-71 Blackbird makes a comeback anytime soon. However, Skunk Works from Lockheed Martin actually released that they might be working on an SR-72 UAV that is supposedly going to be flying at Mach 6 or twice the speed of the SR-71. So at least we have something to look forward to, right? Thank you so much for watching to the very end. What did you think of my first video? Are there any planes you want me to cover? Are there topics I should talk about more? Leave them in the comments below. And don't forget to like and subscribe, and I'll see you next week.